All right, well, I just want to welcome you. I want to give everyone an opportunity to come inside. And I want to welcome to the stage one of my heroes, Kristen Hawkins, the president of Students for Life of America. Welcome, Kristen!
Your arm is amazing there on that last one. You guys got to give Tina way to the hand. That was some amazing throwing there. That last
They're
one
like
was
a girl.
Really far. I'm impressed. Well, I want to thank you all. I want to truly thank you all for making the journey to our national conference this year, for deciding to spend the day with us. I want to thank you for making that journey to Washington, D.C. yesterday, although it wasn't too much of a sacrifice compared to previous years. We didn't suffer enough, I don't think. It was actually warm. I was actually sweating at some points. The pro-abortion protesters at the Supreme Court, they had a very large contingent of 10 people, so I'm in advance of their Women's March today. But I want to thank you truly for standing up for life and deciding to make this journey. I know it's not easy for a lot of you. We've got students, I think, here today who've come all the way from Alaska. Where are our Alaskan students? Are they here yet? There they are! We've never had this happen! Alaska is here! And what's amazing, we were even able to take you all to your senator's office. I think, you know, the senator from Alaska doesn't think no one's ever going to come bother visit her. Yesterday, the pro-life generation was there. We have students from North Dakota. Are the North Dakota students here yet? There you go. So I want to thank you for making this journey. I know you all fundraised throughout the year. You all sacrificed so much to be here. But I want to thank you for doing this. It's an honor to serve you. It's an honor for our entire team to serve you every day as you set out on your campuses and your communities to transform our culture, to make our nation a place where children are valued, to make our nation a place where women will no longer have to choose between the life of her child and her education, or the life she's always dreamed for herself. And yesterday, I hope you could feel it when we were in Washington, D.C. marching. I hope you could sense it, that it's paying off. Your hard work, your dedication, your sacrifice is paying off. I hope you can feel the momentum our movement has today in America. Things are different. You know, we often like to say this isn't your grandma's pro-life movement. I think we offend some grandmas. It's no offense. The meaning is that we're different. We view abortion differently. You fight it differently. And what the best part about that is now we're winning. We're winning. So I hope you could feel that momentum. Things in Washington, D.C., they're drastically different from where they were last year when we gathered here. And if you don't believe me, if you don't watch the news, I hope you'll take heart in what you see today, in the sessions that we have and the people that you meet. We are making a difference. We are saving lives. We are gaining ground, and there is momentum in the pro-life movement. We see this every day on the campuses. Because of you, because of your sacrifice, because of your dedication, we now have more than 1,200 groups on high school and college campuses in all 50 states. That's huge. Planned Parenthood this year, their annual report they released after Christmas, this $1 billion abortion machine, this abortion Goliath, boasted that they started 50 students' pro-abortion organizations last year. They were proud of the fact that they trained 700 students last year. They grossed over $1 billion. Let me tell you, Students for Life's annual budget is way, way below $1 billion. And we served 1,200 groups. We started 130 groups last year, and we trained more than 11,000 students. We have the momentum. You have the momentum. We see this in our communities. Students in Reading, PA this summer, when Planned Parenthood decided they were going to send a full-time paid employee from their abortion facility that's been cited for multiple health violations, and they were going to put that paid person in the public high school to create that cycle of dependence on Planned Parenthood, create that predatory, create a customer model. It was students in Reading, PA who said, no way. It was students who stood up and went to the school board, who protested in the June summer heat and humidity, who were there in August, who wrote letters to the editor. And because of those students, Reading High School now, there's somebody missing, and that's the Planned Parenthood worker. We have momentum. And in Washington, D.C., in Washington, we now have a Mexico City policy in place where now our taxpayer dollars won't be funding overseas abortions. We have pro-lifers in every branch of the government. We have a Department of Justice who just recently announced they're launching a federal investigation into Planned Parenthood for their trafficking of human baby body parts. David will be here tonight. Make sure you're here at 5 o'clock tonight, by the way. Things are changing. We have that momentum. What further proof? Still unsure if I'm telling the truth? Thursday night, the Vice President of the United States, Mike Pence, and his wife, Karen Pence, they asked us to call them Mike and Karen, allowed Students for Life to come to his office and have a round table. We had 13 Students for Life groups from across the nation represented, sitting down with the Vice President of the United States, talking to him about what we are doing to transform our culture, our nation, the momentum we have. And he said it, I didn't even have to say it. It was before I even handed him the t-shirt. He said, you all are the pro-life generation. Did you hear him say it yesterday when he was introducing the President of the United States? That's momentum. That's progress that we're making. But we have more to do, and I hope you realize that. We have a lot to do, and I have to go through the list fast. But we have First Amendment cases that are coming up in our campuses. We've seen more violations of pro-life student free speech this year than ever any other year. We have to fight back for our rights to speak out. We have a case in California right now. We'll be out doing our California West Coast Conference next week, where the state of California is going to require every state university to dispense the abortion pill RU486, turning every college campus into an abortion facility. We have to stop this legislation because it won't stop in California. It will come for all of our campuses. And we have to continue to talk about Planned Parenthood and defunding of Planned Parenthood. We have to be that broken record because no one wants to talk about it. It's messy. It's not fun. It doesn't make you the favorite person at the party. But we have to talk about it. Truly, I need you today to use this time to recommit yourselves to this human rights movement. I need you to say yes. I will be a David. I will be that David fighting the Goliath of the abortion industry. And you know, I don't know how many of you know the Bible story of David versus Goliath. If you don't know it, go to Wikipedia. But basically, small young kid versus a big giant of the Philistine army. And he was undefeated, right? And if David could win, the Philistines would retreat. And you don't have to be religious to agree with this. This is like history. Historians have studied it. They even know where the battle took place. But when David volunteered and had that courage, he had that courage to fight that Philistine giant, the Goliath. They gave him all this heavy armor, this big sword, and they said, good luck, man. And he knew he wasn't going to win. He knew he wouldn't win if he fought on Goliath's terms, if he used the traditional weapons. He knew he had to do something different. Because he was the underdog. He got rid of that armor. He got rid of that sword. They thought he was crazy. They all said he was crazy. And he took a few stones and a slingshot. And he won. Social scientists, historians have often analyzed this effect of the David versus the Goliath. These fights that go on, military fights, basketball teams, how people who are perceived as weak, who are perceived as having this extreme disadvantage, overcome the obstacle and win. And there's a few key things that every David does to defeat a Goliath. And I want you to keep these things in mind today. One, you have to be relentless. David, you know, and we know, we are at the disadvantage. We have to have a relentless effort that doesn't let up. We have to work harder because we know we're at the disadvantage. You have to be willing. Number two, you have to be willing to be laughed at. Because you can't play by Goliath's rules and defeat him. You have to make up your own rules. You have to think outside of the box. That's why I'm so honored to call David Delight and one of my very good friends. Because David said, we can't fight Planned Parenthood on their terms. We don't have the money. We don't have the political influence. We don't have the media. All he needed was two willing people and video cameras and a really good computer. That was it. You can't beat the Goliath and play on the Goliath's terms. We have to come up with the new rules of the game, with the new terms of engagement. And three, in order to win, in order to be that David that defeats that Goliath in the abortion industry, men and women, we have to stay on mission. We have to stay on mission. A lot of us, we care about a lot of social injustices, and we're involved in a lot of causes. But this human rights battle is too important to be number 10 on our list, on number 5 on our list. Abortion deserves an entire grassroots movement dedicated to eradicating it. We have to stay on mission. We need diversity in our pro-life movement. Look around. We need more diversity. The way we're going to get that diversity, the way we're going to bring in more Democrats and Republicans, liberals, conservatives, atheists, Christians, African Americans, Hispanics, the way we're going to get that diversity is by focusing on one narrow issue and forming an alliance and say, hey, I might disagree with you on this policy. You and I might not agree on capital punishment. We might not agree on health care. We might not agree on immigration, but we all agree on this. And that is abortion is the greatest human rights violation our world has ever known. So men and women, I believe we can abolish abortion. I believe it is possible. We have the momentum. We have to change the way we play. This is our battle. This is the battle of our generation. This is the battle of our lifetime. So my question to you is, are you ready? Are you ready today to be that David? Are you ready to take that momentum? Take that momentum and work harder than you've ever worked before. We can't let up. So many people thought when President Trump was elected, I had people write to me, well, we don't have to do much. What? Are you kidding me? 2,800 babies will die today, and they'll die tomorrow, and they'll die the next day. We're nowhere near where we need to be to create a culture where every life is welcomed, every life is protected, every life is sacred. Are you ready to be that David? To be that relentless fighter who never lets up, who does that full court press like on the basketball court? Are you ready to fight out of the box, to do crazy things like protesting at the Supreme Court when all these pro-lifers are walking by going, why are you protesting? Are you ready to do crazy things like, I don't know, collect 328,000 baby socks and tour the country with them? Are you ready to do crazy things like that? Are you ready to change the rules of the game? Are you ready to stay on mission, stay focused? We need you guys. We need all of us working together as one united movement. I hope you're ready to join us. Thank you.